Ask the Lord of the harvest to send workers into the harvest field. Good morning, saints. And welcome to worship this morning as we gather together under a three-week sermon series theme entitled Life Lessons. And this morning we'll take a look at the life lesson that there's more work than workers. The order of service that we will follow this morning is either in your worship folder or you can follow along on the screens as well. Let us then begin the worship of our Lord and Savior this morning with the singing of our first hymn. Please rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessed are they whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed are they whose sin the Lord does not count against them. Let us confess our sins to the Lord. Almighty and merciful Father, we have strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed what we have devised and desired in our hearts. We have offended you and sinned against your holy law. We have done those things that we should not have done, and we have not done those things that we should have done. Have mercy on us, Lord. Spare us, forgive us, and restore us, according to your promises in Christ Jesus. God, our merciful Father, has forgiven all our sins. He sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Redeemer and Savior. Jesus paid the penalty for our guilt by his death on the cross and freed us from death by his resurrection from the grave. We have peace with God now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty, eternal God, in the word of your apostles and prophets, you have proclaimed to us your saving will. Grant us faith to believe your promises, that we may receive eternal salvation. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first reading this morning is taken from the book of Numbers in chapter 27. The Lord would be calling Moses home soon, but there was still work to be done. So he tells Moses to appoint Joshua to continue the work of leading God's people. Moses said to the Lord, "May the Lord, the God who gives breath to all living things, appoint someone over this community to go out and come in before them, one who will lead them out and bring them in, so the Lord's people will not be like sheep without a shepherd." So the Lord said to Moses, "Take Joshua, son of Nun, a man in whom is the spirit of leadership, and lay your hand on him. Have him stand before Eleazar the priest and the entire assembly and commission him in their presence. Give him some of your authority, so the whole Israelite community will obey him. He is to stand before Eleazar the priest, who will obtain decisions for him by inquiring of the Urim before the Lord. At his command, he and the entire community of the Israelites will go out, and at his command, they will come in." Moses did as the Lord commanded him. He took Joshua and had him stand before Eleazar the priest and the whole assembly. Then he laid his hands on him and commissioned him, as the Lord instructed through Moses. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We join together in singing our psalm for today, Psalm 100. second reading is taken from Paul's first letter to the church in Corinth in chapter 4. Here Paul says without apology that those who have been given a trust must prove faithful in what is being proved faithful. That is being faithful to the word of the Lord. This then is how you ought to regard us, as servants of Christ, as those entrusted with the mysteries God has revealed. Now it is required that those who have been given a trust must prove faithful. I care very little if I'm judged by you or any human court. Indeed, I do not even judge myself. My conscience is clear. But that does not make me innocent. It is the Lord who judges me. Therefore, judge nothing before the appointed time. Wait until the Lord comes. He will bring to light what is hidden in darkness and will expose the motives of the heart. At that time, each will receive their praise from God. Now, brothers and sisters, I've applied these things to myself and Apollos for your benefit, so that you may learn from us the meaning of the saying, do not go beyond what is written. Then you will not be puffed up in being a follower of one of us over against the other. For what makes you different from anyone else? What do you have that you did not receive? And if you did not receive it, why do you boast as though you did not? The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please rise for the reading of the gospel. Hallelujah. Has the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into his harvest field. Hallelujah. The gospel according to Matthew chapter 9. Now Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them, because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. Jesus called the 12 disciples to him and gave them the authority to drive out impure spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, who is called Peter, and his brother Andrew, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Do not go among the Gentiles or enter any town of the Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. As you go, proclaim this message. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick. Raise the dead. Cleanse those who have leprosy. Drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. The gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ. You may be seated for our next hymn, O Christ who called the 12.
Grace and peace to you from God the Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, let's look at the words that were read as the gospel lesson from Matthew chapter 9 and the beginning part of chapter 10. In a few months, you will see it with your own eyes, something like the picture that Jesus draws for us with his words today. A harvest that is ripe. The corn is going to be up in a few months. It will be tall and green with ears on it. And the farmer who planted it will be looking to harvest it. The farmer cares a great deal for that crop. He expended time and energy to plant seeds in the ground. He brought in irrigation. He prayed for rain. He put on pesticides, insecticides, and nutrients so that it would grow healthy. He has a lot invested in that crop, and he did all of those things not so much because he liked doing them, but because he wanted to see a crop. And when he sees that crop, he knows that the crop does nobody any good, doesn't do him or his family or others good, unless it is brought in as a harvest. And so he needs to find a way to bring it in. I suppose today, with relatively little manpower, pretty big crops can be brought in with the machines that go out and drive through the fields. But imagine this farmer with a huge cornfield and no machines. He's not able to do it all by himself in a timely way, and so he gets workers. He gets people from his family, he hires others, and they go to pick the ears of corn so that it can feed his family and so that it can be sold to others. Jesus says, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. How does God see our world? The very world in which we live, how does he see the people of our world in whose number we are included? He sees it as a ripe harvest. He sees them as the individual stalks of corn that need to be harvested and brought in. And Jesus changes the picture a little bit to show just what he feels about that harvest and each individual plant person in that field. He looked out at the people who were before him that day, and the same can be said about the people that he sees in the world today. They are harassed and they are helpless. They are like sheep without a shepherd. They're wandering around confused. They need somebody to lead them. They're moving in places that are dangerous. They need somebody to protect them. And he's filled with compassion. And that word is like the gut feeling kind of compassion. That his heart went out for them. His heart broke for them. He saw their needs. He saw their desperate condition. And he wanted to do something about it. And then we're told he did. A day or a couple of days are summarized in the verses that we heard read. Did you hear what Jesus was doing? He went from town to town and from village to village, and he went to their synagogues, to the places where the people were gathered. And he spoke to them and he taught to them, and we're told that he taught unlike the other teachers of the law. Because his message wasn't piling on more things to do, but was relieving the people of their burdens with the message of a perfect Messiah. His message wasn't about them doing more so that they could compare favorably with others and receive the merit of God, but was asking them to see him as the Messiah who had come to do what they could never do, and to do it in their place and to do it perfectly well, so that they would have, get this, peace with their God. And peace in their hearts. And an eternal future secure, all in him. The kingdom of heaven is drawing near. Jesus could say it's drawing near. I'm drawing near to you today. And then he went out and he saw the people who were sick and who had diseases and who were demon-possessed, and he took care of those needs. He healed the sick, cast out demons, and all of these things as signs of what he had truly come to do, to bring healing to the nations through his life and through his death, and then through his taking up life again and making it available to all. I'm told that in the series The Chosen, maybe some of you have seen that, that when this scene is depicted, Jesus comes home from that work and goes to his disciples, and it's nighttime, and he's been at it all day. And much different than the picture that I often have of Jesus after days like this, you know, he is just a mess. Completely worn out physically and on his clothes, like smeared blood and mucus and stuff, because he had been with the sick people and he had been loving them and hugging them and healing them. He had been having compassion on them as a shepherd for the sheep. He had been teaching them because they had been so mixed up in their minds so often about who God is and how to get to him. And so he came to them with words like this: I am the way and the truth and the life. You have access to the Father through me. And then he says to his disciples, I need you guys and gals. I need you. I need you. Isn't it amazing? The great good shepherd with perfect compassion, the great good shepherd chooses to need others, chooses to need his disciples, and he calls on them to hear what he has to say to them. What does he say? Pray. Pray to the Lord of the harvest that he would send workers out into his harvest field. It's very simple. It's very easy. It's something that any one of us, whether you are 2 years old or 92 years old, can do. It's something that you can do in the morning or the evening or any time during the day. Something that you can do day by day and week by week. It is a prayer that never ceases to be needed, because the truth is always this: there is more work than there are workers. So pray to the Lord of the harvest that he would send workers into his harvest field. And you know, lest we maybe lose the point or go home today and forget about what the Lord has called us to do, let's pause right here. Having heard his voice, let's pause right here and pray. Lord Jesus, you are the Lord of the harvest, and we ask you boldly to send workers into your harvest field. In your name we pray, amen. When Jesus tells us to pray, and when he tells us to pray for specific things, we can be certain that he will hear and he will answer those prayers. Isn't that amazing? We can be certain that he will hear and he will answer the prayers of his people. We've seen it just in our own little church body. The past couple of weeks at our schools, there have been graduations and assignments made. At Martin Luther College, there were approximately 150 people, young people, who train for the ministry and have been sent out to churches and schools like ours, in the name of the shepherd and in our name too. And at the seminary a couple of weeks ago, there were 45-ish young men who presented themselves for public ministry and were sent out. That is the Lord of the harvest answering the prayers of his people. It should be noted that there were also 150 calls for teachers that went unfilled, that are vacancies right now, and about that same number of pastoral vacancies in our synod. The prayer is still needed by God's people for workers. But it is not just for workers like those who stand before you and preach, or those who stand in classrooms and teach. Did you notice how Jesus answered the prayer of his people that day? Did you notice it? Pray to the Lord for workers. You, and you, now go. I wonder if some of Jesus' disciples that day, and we have the list of the apostles there, I wonder if some of them said, oh, wait. You know, we were praying for workers because you told us to, but we didn't know that you were going to then answer our prayer by sending us. I wonder if that was the thought, or I wonder if maybe they had thoughts in their minds like, well, we're not ready, or we don't think that we can do this, or somebody else could do a better job. You know, those first four that are listed for sure were fishermen: Simon, Andrew, James, John. And throughout the Gospels, we've gotten to know them, and they had their character flaws as well. One of the other ones was a tax collector. Like, he was good at collecting taxes, and he kind of knew how to beat and cheat the system, but going out in Jesus' name to preach and heal and stuff like that. One of them, the zealot, that was a name for these people who were really into governmental things and, like, make Israel great again, and we want our freedom. But going out to preach about the kingdom of God, the prayer was answered by the very people who prayed. Hopefully it's starting to kind of click in our minds here. How does God answer the prayer for workers? He answers it with the very people who are praying to him. And certainly that has to do with what we would call public called ministers of the gospel. There is a need for that, for people who are trained in the word and then speak the word and lead people in the word. How does God answer the call for workers like that? Might it be that he answers with people who are in this room? People who are sitting to your left, or to your right, or in front of you, or behind you, maybe you yourself? Might that be the answer to our prayer? I really don't doubt that it is, at least in part. Young people, God can use you in those ways. He can. Older people, he could use you in those ways too. Young people, if you're wondering, like, how could I do that thing? Like, how could I speak in front of people or teach people? I'll share at least with you personally how I came to be a pastor. It wasn't because I had like some big revelation in the sky saying, hey, you're the man. And it wasn't because like from little on, like I was a practice pastor and I just couldn't wait to get out and do that. You know why I became a pastor? Because a bunch of people said, you know what, our church body could really use pastors. And then some other people said, you know what, we think that you could be a pastor. And so I went and I studied to be a pastor. And in case you wonder, like, well, can I do those things? Like, God is really good to us. I can remember when I was in 10th grade and had to give a speech. I hated giving speeches, hated it. And I can remember I did one on The Raven by Edgar Allan Poe. And at one point, I'd memorized this poem. At one point, I pointed to the raven who was on the door. And like 10 minutes later, when the professor was saying, do you know that you were pointing to the raven the entire rest of your speech? Like, oh, no, I didn't. I forgot to take my hand down. Do you know that on call day, assignment day, I was terrified? I didn't really want to go, and I didn't think I could do it. And some people who are close to me could tell you that there have been plenty of times where I've said the same, even recently. It's not because of who you are. It's not because of how smart you are or how gifted you are. It's because you have the one thing needed, which is this. You know the shepherd. And you're pointing people not to trust in you, but to trust in the shepherd. You're leading people not to your great wisdom, not to your great skills, but you're leading them to the healing skills of the shepherd, and you get to announce things in his name like this. You are forgiven. You are loved. You are an heir of eternal life, all in Jesus the shepherd. And not everything's fun, but there's an awful lot that is, like this, getting a text from a friend with a mailbox with a number on it. And he says, there's a guy who lives at this address on Grandview Boulevard, and I told him that you were going to come and see him because his best friend just died of cancer, and he doesn't know where to turn, and he needs some help. A hurting, harassed sheep in need of a shepherd. And I get to go in Jesus' name, in your name, to share with him the hope that we have. It is possible for any one of you, but I'm just going to say one thing in closing. It's also not necessary for any one of you. Because God answers the prayer of his people, he answers your prayer with shepherds for sheep in all kinds of different ways. Whether it is the mom and the dad who takes aside a child who is scared. Scared of dying and scared of living in this world, and they take him aside and say, here's what Jesus says. He says, I love you and I'm with you always, every step of the way. And when you die, whenever that may be, guess what? He's going to take you to be with him in an unimaginably great and glorious place to live in peace and joy with him forever. That is shepherding of hurting, harassed, and helpless sheep. Or it comes when a neighbor who is normally outgoing suddenly becomes withdrawn, and you go over to their house with a plate of cookies and you say, hey, is everything okay? And they say, no. No. My wife just got diagnosed with cancer, and I think I'm going to lose my job, and I am on the brink of despair. And you get to say to them, you need some hope? I know where to find hope. And you get to introduce them to the shepherd. The shepherd who promises to work even evil for good. The shepherd who promises that he can overcome even the sting of death by his own resurrection from the dead. And promises to dry the eyes of sorrowing people with his precious and comforting promises. Shepherding of herding sheep happens all the time through God's people, through you. It happens on the phone. It happens on front porches. It happens in office spaces and hospital rooms. Jesus does hear our prayer, and he does answer. But let's be prepared to hear what the answer is. Hurting and harassed sheep in your world need a shepherd too. And because you know the good shepherd who has come to you through his shepherds all throughout your life, who comes to you now by his word through his shepherds, because you know him, you are equipped to do what he calls on you to do as the answer to our prayers. There will always be more work than workers, and there will always be harassed and helpless sheep, but Jesus cares. And Jesus hears prayers, and Jesus answers with his people. May God bless you as you see the harvest fields the same way that he does, and as you get to work in his name. Amen. Please stand. Peace of God that goes beyond all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. We take this opportunity to confess our Christian faith, the faith that has been placed into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, and a faith that we share with millions of Christians around the globe and throughout time preceding us and yet to come, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated for prayer.
We pray. Father, you have made us, and we are yours. Your faithfulness continues through all generations. Appoint faithful shepherds to watch over your people, instruct them with your word, that they may share the grace they have freely received. There are many people who are harassed and helpless, like lost sheep without a shepherd. Bring them also. Open our mouths to speak your word. Send messengers into all the earth to spread your kingdom and gather your flock. We give thanks for those who serve and help the sick, the aged, and the dying. Give them strength to do their work. Give them patience when they endure stress. Move them to reflect your love. Just as your Spirit creates and strengthens faith in us, by his power open our lips to confess your saving truths before the world. You healed every disease and sickness. Have mercy on all who are distressed in mind or body. Shepherd them through difficult times and give them your peace, your help, and your healing. Heavenly Father, we thank you for providing earthly fathers. The care they give and the compassion they show are a reflection of your love. Help them in their most important work of bringing up their children in the training and instruction of the Lord. Let your grace and forgiveness always be at the heart of their family leadership. Strengthen them to model for their children a godly life and bless all they do to provide for the needs of their families. And Father, on day 6, when you brought the woman to the man of the mankind, you established marriage for the benefit of the mankind and society. Therefore, it is with joy we come before you today and join with Mark and Gail Bladel in thanking you for this gift as they celebrate 39 years of marriage. Let their marriage not only be a blessing for them, but a benefit to society. Cause their love for you to grow, so that in turn their love for one another is strengthened. Give them what they need to this end. Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God, you gave your holy apostles power to heal the sick, raise the dead, and drive out demons. Strengthen us by your grace, that in your might we may proclaim your message, do your wonders, and serve you with pure hearts. With the Father and the Holy Spirit, we worship and glorify you, one God, now and forever. Amen. And as the offerings of God's people are brought forward, we join together in singing our next hymn, God of Grace and God of Glory. Blessed Lord, you have given us your holy scriptures for our learning. May we so hear them, read, learn, and take them to heart, that being strengthened and comforted by your holy word, we may cling to the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. We join together in our final hymn for this morning. O God, your hand the heavens made. God's richest grace and blessing and peace are yours. Just one announcement this morning, and that is tomorrow evening at 6:30, we'll gather together for a congregational meeting to discuss and vote on the upcoming budget for this fiscal year starting July 1st. If you would like to see a copy of the proposed budget, there are some copies available for you on the table there in the narthex, so feel free to pick one of those up on your way out. And also, happy Father's Day to all of the fathers out there. May God continue to give you his word so that you can lead and support your family in the training and instruction of his word and lead your family to the one true and only God and Savior of the world. Saints of God, may you have a very wonderful week and rejoice in the salvation that is yours and the privilege it is that you have to proclaim to others. Have a wonderful day.